Hey everybody, good morning. And we're about to begin just shortly. Please be patient, get ready. We're gonna start about 3 minutes after. So we got about two more minutes after the next song. So please be patient, get ready. I'm waiting for the last few people to jump on and we will be starting in just a minute. All right, everybody, and good morning and welcome to today's event. What does a giraffe know about money, right? This is a big event put on by a great individual, somebody who's been kind of a mentor to our organization for quite some time. So before I begin, guys, if you are, of course, are new to Freedom or you've never been part of or you don't know who we are, of course, Freedom is an awesome insurance agency that puts together financial plans and strategies for people to build long-term wealth and protect the things that they love and value in life. And so if you have not had the opportunity to meet my name is David, and David Bettis. I'm CEO and founder of Freedom Insurance, and we've got Raul Gomez on here, and we have our presenter, which I'll be introducing just right now. But please, of course, if you want to learn more about Freedom or know more about what we do and how we help people throughout the communities, please reach out to me. So, all right, let's get the show on the road. So today I want to introduce a best-selling author of 16 books, consultant to thousands of millionaires, even a few billionaires. The guy's a top producer, one of the top producers for a few carriers out there. And he does this all part-time while being a father, a world traveler, because I've seen him travel. He's been interviewed by great organizations like A&E, Bravo, Bloomberg, and I can probably imagine thousands of podcasts. He works closely with Jack Cranfield, which is the guy who writes Chicken Soup for the Soul, and he's done so many other great things in the world. And I want to introduce today's presenter, Mr. Chris Jarvis. Come on, Chris. You ready, man?
I am ready. How are you, David?
I'm doing great, man. Let me go ahead and turn this over to you so you can take the reins and show us the way, my man. All right. Go ahead and show is all yours.
Fantastic. Thank you, everybody. I am glad you are here. I am happy to be here with you. Teaching is one of my loves, and luckily I've had a pretty good career going through all this lovely, my career in finance has been pretty solid. So I'm very, very happy to be here with you guys and teach you a couple things, show you some things that I've learned from working with very wealthy people. I've worked with very successful advisors, agents, centers of influence, referral sources, you name it. And would love to give you guys some of this, some of this fantastic knowledge, hopefully, and it'll be valuable to you. So let me see if I can get this thing to, David, bear with me. I'm just trying to share my screen and deal with, I am not your chief technology officer, so you can absolutely not lean on me for that. So let's see what I can do. So if I share my screen here, and you can tell me in a minute if this is going to go. How are we doing? You guys getting this okay?
Yeah, sure. We can see you. Go ahead.
Perfect. All right. So I'm going to fly through this a little bit. A little bit of background here. I've done a number of things. I'm not going to read all of this to you, but I was a mathematician and actuary, which of course makes sense why I'm teaching sales training. The background of going to business school, I sold a company for millions of dollars in 2016. I spent a lot of time educating people ever since. So I sit on the board of a medical school and a business school, a number of nonprofits, and I help business owners around the country. So I'm very happy to be here. As David mentioned, I've written a number of books. I've been on a lot of TV and radio and other things. And that exposure has attracted me to people that I'll call giraffes. And I'll explain what that means in a little bit. But essentially what happened in my career was, as a mathematician, I figured out that the thing that I could do better than anybody else was I could figure out how to help people save taxes. And what was most interesting about that is, well, what's not interesting is, or unsurprising to you, should be the people who want to save taxes the most are the people who make the most money. And what I found in working with thousands of very wealthy people is that to make a lot of money, people do a lot of really wacky stuff. So while I was helping people with taxes, learning how they deal with money, how they think about money, I was also getting a fantastic 20-year masterclass in how do you become super successful and how do you do wacky stuff and how do you think differently, act differently. And that's a big part of what we're going to try and do today and show you how to apply that to your current situation right now. Just to age myself a little bit, I'm almost 50. The richest man in the world when I was growing up was a guy by the name of John Paul Getty. And people had asked John Paul Getty, are there any secrets to becoming rich? And he said, quite frankly, there are. It's really a simple formula. There are only three things you have to do to become very rich. They said, oh, great. You know, Mr. Getty, what are those three things? He said, you need to wake up early, you need to work hard, and you need to find oil. And Getty was an oil man. And with this, there was a little bit of, there's a little bit of humor in there, but there's also a really important nugget in that, in the simplicity of his statement of get up early, work hard, find oil. Two of those things are things that everybody does. And the third thing is something that very few people do. And that's the getting hit by lightning. That's the really lucky shot. And the idea here behind Getty's advice is that if you just do what everybody else does, you get up early and you work hard, the people who are going to become super successful are really lucky. And the ones who aren't, don't. And the piece here is that you can't just get up early and work hard to become successful. You have to do something differently from other people. And that's going to be a big theme throughout today's presentation. What I found in writing the last two books, and the most recent one is Giraffe Money, which was released last month, became a bestseller right away. The byline of this book is really important. It's See Better Paths to Elevated Wealth. And I'll get into the giraffe metaphor a little bit further. But the four billionaire secrets that I found in talking to people, folks who become, and you don't need to be a billionaire, but this is for the clients worth 100 million, 10 million, 5 million, folks who are outliers, who are super successful in any business. It could be sales, it could be in import, export, oil, franchising, you name it. Every person I interviewed for the last two books I did, they all said the same thing. So what was really important were there were four things that were really important to them. Number one was to take responsibility. It's on you, not anybody else, to get this done. It's your life, while you are, it's you. The second thing is billionaires never want to fit in. They are not trying to fit in. They recognize that to get to a place other people aren't, you're going to have to leave other people. You're going to have to do things they haven't done. You're going to have to separate yourself. The third thing is they love change. Change, disruption, political change, law change, regulation change, culture change, social change, all of it. The people with money love change. This change is what they want. And that may come as a bit of a surprise to some of you who feel like, ooh, I like things to go the way they're going. Great. But the people who become super successful, they want change. And I'll explain why in a minute. And then they also value time over money. That to get someplace at a higher level, time they will never get back. They would always buy more time if they could. And so we're going to talk about how these four particular lessons work and how to apply them to you and how to apply them with the clients, the prospects, the referral sources that you want to work with. So lesson number one, your success is all on you. You're the only person responsible for your success, for your happiness. And I remember that was advice my dad gave me years ago, going through some interesting times where I had a business divorce, I had a personal divorce, I had a number of things. And he said, you only get to do this once. This is on you. If you're going to be happy, if you're going to be successful, you have to make these things happen. It's not anybody else's responsibility. It's not mine. It's not your kids. It's not your spouse. It's not your business partners. It's not your friends, your clients. It's on you. It's your life. And if you end up not getting what you want out of life, the only person who's responsible for that is you. And I took that to heart. And that real secret for success is to take 100% responsibility for your life. Now, that means in any situation, the best thing you can do is to realize that, is to look at it as if you're 100% responsible. And people say, well, you're in a relationship, you're in a marriage, you have a business partner, like this is a 50-50 thing. But what I find is that when you say, oh, it's 50-50, but something goes wrong at home, it's your spouse's 50% that caused the problem, it's not yours. So, but when you look at something as it's 100% responsibility and you take it upon yourself, you do things differently. So I adopted my two stepkids earlier this year. And it was one of those things where as teenagers, they were becoming a little more difficult to deal with. And rather than sit in the, you're teenagers, you're jackasses, you're selfish, you're not really appreciating the situation, my take was, you know what, maybe if I go forward with the adoption, I'll show them that things are different, that I care. And it actually made a major change. And I didn't do it at a time when we were particularly close. I did it at a time when things weren't fantastic. Again, if any of you have teenagers, you know that, you know, There are more not fantastic times than there are fantastic times as they're trying to grow and figure out what's important to them and they're testing boundaries, and which is very natural and normal, but it's not particularly fun for the adults who are trying to, trying to parent them. So, but that idea was I could blame them or I could just see what could I do. So the idea of adopting them was I'm going to take responsibility and say, what could I do to try and make this better? Well, I'm going to try and give them some comfort and give them some, a shot in the arm that, hey, I'm here for you and I'm here for you legally, completely. They've been with me for 10 years, so it's not a big, it wasn't a big surprise, but that's just one example of how do you do something that's more 100% responsibility. The reason why this is so important is that in this very, very simple equation, you have events in life, and then once those events happen, you get to decide how you respond. And when you take the event plus your response, that gives you an outcome. And I know so many people who want a better outcome in their life, but they keep talking about the events. Did you see what happened here? Did you see what Trump said? Did you see what Pelosi said? Did you see how the Fed is handling this? Did you see how the company changed their rules? Can you see how FINRA is doing things differently? Can you see how David and Raul are doing things differently? Like, none of that stuff matters. Like, that's life. Life is going to throw stuff at you all the time. The big thing is, how do you respond? Rather than focusing on the event, very quickly look at the event. It is what it is. Move on. Have no emotional attachment to the event and get on how can you respond to that event to get to a better outcome. And what I find is that the most successful people never look back. It's just, this happened. Okay, now what am I going to do? And if it's a regulatory thing you don't like, either you respond to it or you go lobby and make it and try and lobby it back. But to talk about it and whine about it and bitch and moan doesn't do anybody any good. It wastes a ton of time. And now all your focus is on a negative thing. And it really should be on what do you do now? Life is going to throw things at you. Nothing's perfect. So this idea that you have to, if you want to change an outcome, you have to focus on your response. And unfortunately, most people, especially salespeople I see who wallow in the, I'm not making as much as I could. I really should be making more. Somebody who makes more money than I do. That person's not smarter, not nicer, not whatever it might be. There's something, they're all focusing on the events in their life, and they're really not looking at the responses. And if you want to be super successful, you've got to give up all the blaming. You have to stop worrying about it's the economy, it's COVID, it's restrictions, it's Trump, it's the Democrats, it's the president, it's whatever it might be. It doesn't matter. It's the company, it's underwriting, it's my clients. It's nobody's fault. There's no fault to be had. This is just life. You have to look at everything in your life and say, what do I do now? So if you want to get things out of your life, if you start acting as if it's all on you, what can I do? You will move forward and take some action and do something rather than sit in the mess that's going on around you. And there's certainly a lot of messes, and we'll talk about how some of that's bad and some of it's actually really good for you in a little bit. But you have to get past this blaming thing. And I mean, how do you feel when someone comes up and talks to you about some terrible thing that happened, or blame, you know, is worried about the school board or the Texas Education Association or the whatever the hell it is? It just doesn't matter. I mean, those things that are happening, okay, they happened. We identify them. Now, what do we do? It's what next? Now what? We used to have that statement posted on the wall in my old company. It was just now what? It doesn't matter why. It's just now what? What do we do next? What's next? What else? Like, those are questions to be asking, not the why and all the BS that goes around that. So once you give up the blaming and the complaining and the justifying and everything else, you'll move one thing. But you change your mindset will change everything. So if you're not getting what you want out of life right now, if you don't have the health you want, if you don't have the finances you want, if you don't have the relationships you want, or you're not having the fun that you want or the impact that you want, think of it as it's you. Don't worry about all the other people. Just say, I'm going to change my mindset and do something to move forward. And the career that you've chosen is one that you can make change. You have a lot of freedom, no pun intended or pun intended, depending on how you look at this. You have a lot of freedom to get to where you want to be and to do things differently. But the first thing you have to do is change the way you think. And it's so important to change the way you think and get past the blaming and looking back and just look forward to, I can do something. What am I going to do? Let's move forward and make something happen. So once you do all of that, that's a positive. So the first thing they had was the mindset. The second thing is different is better than better. This was the other idea of not wanting to fit in. And really successful people, when I interviewed them for both books, both the Six Secrets to Leveraging Success book, which is about entrepreneurship, and Giraffe Money, which is about making money and keeping money. The research I did with this was I wanted to look at people who were all the way you're looking at this is all the way out in this normal distribution. They're all the way out in the tail. And I'm not going to give you guys math or statistics homework, but a normal distribution doesn't mean that everybody looks the same. It doesn't mean that everybody acts the same. It doesn't mean that everybody has the same thing. What it means is that the closer you are to the average, the more people you will have that are around that. And the further away you get, the fewer people you will have. So as a perfect example, if the average height in the United States is 5'6", then you would expect there to be a lot of people between 5'4" and 5'8". And you'd expect there to be not a lot of people who are 3 feet tall or 7 feet tall. And that holds true. And that's the way it is with income as well, that you would assume if the average family has income of $63,060, then you'd have fewer people making 10 or 20,000 and you'd have very few people making a million. So as I was looking at these people at the far end, I said, these people are giraffes. They're giraffes because they stand out above other people. They have more, they've been more successful. But it wasn't just that. As I dug deeper into the giraffe metaphor, I found that it wasn't just that they became higher, that they grew bigger. It's because of what they got from that. And again, I'll dig into it a little bit. When I was studying for both books and redoing research, Emmanuel Saez did some economic research and he won the international prize for his income inequality. And what he found was these really interesting things. $63,000 is the average American family. But if you take the top 10% out, 90% of families make less than $40,000 as an average. So the top 10 is really bringing the number up, which means there's a lot of people not making very much money at all. He also found that to be in the top 1%, that meant your family made $400,000 a year or more. To get into the top 0.1%, so the one in 1,000, you're over 2 million. and the 0.01%, one in 10,000 people make $11 million a year. So it gets really, really, I guess this way for you, it gets really big. The income numbers get really big, the more of an outlier you are. And so where do you want to be? This is a really interesting thing because folks in our industry make a wide range of incomes. And why is that? We're going to talk about that a little bit, not only why it's that way, but how you can separate yourself and stand above all these people. Why is that so important? There are over 1 million licensed insurance agents in the United States, over 1 million. And every one of us, you, me, and everyone else, we all sell the exact same products at the exact same price, and we're all selling them to the same people. So we are selling the same products at the same price to the same people. There is nothing, not a single thing any one of us can do to make the product any different. So if any one of us pitches a product to somebody, it will not cost anything different. It will not behave any different. It will be exactly the same. So somehow when everything's the same, the product is the same, the price is the same, it's all the same, somehow you have to find a way to differentiate yourself and stand out in this big field of people who are all doing the same thing. So it seems like a pretty harsh reality that there's really no way to differentiate yourself with the product. And it might seem a little bit daunting, but I can tell you there is a way for you to get to the next level. Just because it's a one in a million chance for you to stand out doesn't mean that you can't. You absolutely can. And that's a positive thinking. If you notice the graphic, this is from Jim Carrey from Dumb and Dumber. He's talking to Lauren Holly and asked her what the odds are of somebody like her going out with a guy like him. And he said, 1 in 100, 1 in 10, give it to me straight. She says, 1 in 1,000,000. And he stops for a minute and then says, so you're saying there's a chance. So this idea of looking positively, I can still get there. I can stand out. I can be different. You can be in the 1%. I was having this conversation on a podcast yesterday talking about how when I had a job as an actuary and I was making between $30,000 and $50,000 in the 90s, and that was quite a bit of money, I remember saying to myself, God, when I make $100,000, I will be so flush. Everything will be paid for. I can do everything I want, and life will be really easy. And right now, if I made that, I'm not sure that I could pay to keep my house and basic living expenses at all. I mean, I certainly couldn't live in my house for that. So you have these thoughts, but whatever you think is big is big, and you want to keep pushing and pushing. And I'm going to show you how to do that too. So what's really important is in the insurance world, you can't differentiate yourself with the products at all. It has nothing to do with the products or the companies you represent. Zero. David mentioned that I've been a multi-million dollar producer many years and have won awards from tons of companies. I do it part-time. I sell one or two cases a year. I only did one case this year, but it was pretty substantial, probably $600,000 a target. It was very good, for me and my family. But the point of this is you have to find some way to differentiate yourself so that you can do the things you want to do. And I'm going to show you how to do some of that too. So a perfect example about sales, if anybody's ever driven a Volvo, Volvo has their Volvo overseas delivery model. If you've ever been to a car dealer, I'm not sure what your experience is with this, but I hate the idea of buying a car. I hate dealing with the car dealer and the F&I person, and it drives me crazy. And a lot of companies know that Carvana, you don't negotiate your price. I have a Tesla X, and that was a car that you can't negotiate the price. You buy it online and there's no negotiation. Saturn did that and was very successful for a long time. And the reason why is because people don't like working with car dealers and feeling like they were taken advantage of. They don't want to find out they bought a car for $43,000 that somebody else might have paid $42,000 for. They feel bad. So what did Volvo do? Volvo didn't just say, we're going to go from a haggling model to a non-haggling model. They decided to completely change the game and go way off to the other end. So they said, well, if most people find the car buying experience to be a big pain in the butt, we're going to try and make it an awesome experience. So what does that mean? If you buy a car from Volvo Overseas Delivery, you buy the car, you get it at a discount off sticker. And then what they do is when the car is coming off the lot, they send you two business class tickets and they put you up in a 4-star hotel in Sweden. So you can go see your car come off the line, drive it around their test track. And then if you want to stay a few more days, that price is on you. But your flight has been taken care of. Your hotel is taken care of. They give you a tour of Volvo and they set you up with some tour people locally. You can extend the trip if you want. And then the car gets shipped back to your home. So now buying a car gives you a trip to Sweden as opposed to 4 hours sitting in the finance and insurance person's office dealing with aggravation. So they went a whole different direction. And I was giving this presentation for a large insurance company up in Chicago to their top 300-400 agents. Somebody raised his hand and said, I did this. And I had no idea where that was going to go. I took a chance and said, how was it? And he said, it was extraordinary. And the car was even cheaper than we thought it was going to be. It was much cheaper than going to a dealer. So Volvo found a way to make the car buying experience even better, even though that Volvo that you purchase is no different from the one you get from a dealer or you might get from another online purchasing distributor. They said, you can buy directly from us and we're going to make this thing extraordinary. So think about that. I mean, they're in a car buying situation, very similar to you. The car is going to be the same. So the big takeaway for this one is if you aren't different, back to John Paul Getty's comment, if you aren't different and you just get up early and work hard, some people are going to find oil and some aren't. And if unless you want luck to be the big story at the end of your life, I had some luck, I didn't have some luck, then you have to find a way to be different. Once you get to that point where you're taking responsibility for your life, you're accepting that different is better than better, you want to embrace change. I said that people who are super successful love change. They love it. They want there to be disruption. Tony Robbins said the quality of your life is directly related to how much uncertainty you can comfortably handle. The more risk you're willing to take, the more uncertainty you have, the greater the quality of your life. So you take some chances, you have some wonder, you see some things, and then great things will happen. If you do the same thing all the time, you're going to keep getting the same results. If I leave math and statistics and go into psychology class for a minute, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. These are things that they say the brain works, and how the human brain works is that you first have physiological needs. You need air, you need water, you need food, you need shelter. If you can't live, if you're not protected from the elements, or you don't have nutrition, or you can't breathe, you're not thinking about what is the meaning of life. You're not trying, you're just worried about survival. Once you get past basic survival needs, the next thing is safety. You need to feel comfortable in where you are. If you're looking over your shoulder, whether it's because you're being chased by a bear, or you're looking over your shoulder at work because you feel like somebody's going to take advantage of you, or you're in a bad relationship and you worry about the person you're with trying to make your life difficult, or whatever the personal or professional thing that has you looking over your shoulder, if you're worried, it's very hard again for you to be in a place where you can move forward and have loving relationships and have impact in life and have joy and do the things that you want. So you start with the basic survival, then you move to safety. After safety is love and belonging. Once you have your living, you feel safe, then you can move on to love, belonging, and being part of a group. And this is where somewhere between the love and the belonging and the esteem is the difference between super successful people and successful people. Most people have a herd mentality and they never leave the safety thing. So if we think about animals, zebras, and giraffes, a giraffe is non-migratory and it doesn't live in big giant herds, but zebras do, as do impala and buffalo and a lot of other migrating animals. But there's safety in the herds. Everybody gets into the herd for safety. And then, well, I'll just be one, if we're with a million people and the lions are going to pick off one a day, well, we'll just play the odds and we'll be okay. Fish do this too when they school. So what they found though is that some people don't leave that pattern and they just want to do what everybody else does. And they want other people to okay their ideas and they want other people to like their ideas and their suggestions. And they want to live where the people want to live. They want to do what other people want to do. Maybe you're in that same place now that you're asking your friends what they're going to do with their kids. Are they going to send them back to school live? Are they going to send them back to school online? How are you going to do it? I mean, quite frankly, it doesn't matter what your friends think. Your friends have a different situation than you do. So I have all three kids are going back to school live. One is going down to the University of Texas and he's going to live there even if his classes are online. My second is going to school because she likes the structure and it just works better for her. Third kid, same thing, but for different reasons. And even in that situation, we have a 78-year-old grandfather with pancreatic cancer and who's not particularly healthy living at home. But at the end of the day, the most important thing for those kids, for their learning, is let's go to school and do what we have. That works for them. And that's coming from my wife, who actually is a virtual online educator, master, who's done this, who's built those schools for other people. So she knows how, she loves online virtual learning, but it's a family by family, kid by kid decision. So this idea that just because our friends are gonna stay home or have online teaching doesn't mean that it's right for our kids. So with all your decisions, why are you asking other people for their advice. And the really important question to ask you here is, you know, has there anything you've done in your life because other people valued it? Somebody thought it'd be really great for you to take this job, live in this place, buy this car, do this thing, buy season tickets, go on this vacation, whatever it might be, that you did because other people did it and you didn't really love it after the fact. You know, think about one or two things you may have done and how did it make you feel. And then the other one that's probably more troubling is think of something that you didn't do that you really wanted to. You wanted to take acting classes. You wanted to learn to play the flute. You wanted to do improv. You wanted to take up karate. You wanted to whatever it was, expand your business, take out a loan, grow your company, hire people, whatever it was. And you didn't do it because of what other people thought and what other people said. And how does that make you feel? At the end of the day, it's your life, it's your obituary, it's your legacy. What kind of life do you want to lead? And I find this one is the most, with the super wealthy people I meet, the ones who get late are not just wealthy people, but any people later in life. The big thing is, what were those things that you didn't do that you wish you had? And you don't want to have those regrets. So this is the place where super successful people are. They don't want other people's ideas at all. They don't care what you think. They have something that's important to them. They will move forward. They'll tell people, but they're not asking for permission. They don't want approval. They're just doing it. So it's okay you don't like it, but you're not going to become as successful as I am. I'm going to do things differently and go somewhere nobody has gone before to get there. Why is this also important? Look at all the companies on the screen. I'm not going to read them all, but these are companies that didn't adapt to change. The world changed and these companies didn't. And as a result, they suffered massive. I mean, some are still in existence, but most of them are not. Certainly only and the ones who are, it's a fraction of what they once were. They did not adapt to the changing market. So this can happen anywhere. It can happen in financial services. So the world is changing. And when I give presentations for entrepreneurs and do the talk of 2020 is the absolute best time to start a business. And I was coaching someone yesterday that I had the same conversation with. And they say, Chris, you're crazy. 2020, it's terrible. This is the worst year ever. And there's all these fantastic memes on Facebook and everywhere else about 2020 and all these silly things about how awful it is. But really, for starting a business or for growing your career, or especially in financial sales, it is a perfect time for you to grow and do things differently. Yes, with the unemployment. Yes, with the potential market crash, which I do think will happen with a ridiculously ugly political situation we're in. The upcoming election, it's only going to get worse. There's social unrest and a lot of social inequality that sucks here in this country that we need to address. And we're in the middle of a pandemic that, quite frankly, we don't know how to handle. So with all those things, why is it that I'm telling you that this is a great time to start a new business? It's for a couple of reasons. Things are changing. People right now are open to change. They're open to doing things differently, thinking about things differently. Instead of going to your nice cushy movie theater and ordering a beer and some food to be delivered to you at the seat, you're going to a drive-in movie, 1978 revisited. So people are open to new things. You're buying movies differently. You're staying up late to stream Hamilton instead of going to New York City. You're going to your doctor on Zoom, right? What a great idea. Do you think that's not going to stick? Doctor's appointments online where the doctor will just call you back when they're free instead of you driving somewhere and sitting in a waiting room and wasting hours and hours. People are seeing so many more patients than ever before. And patients aren't spending as much time. I mean, I love it. So there's a lot of things that are changing. So right now, people are open to change. So if you're trying to give somebody a new path financially, let them look at their lives differently, how to retire faster, how to save money, how to invest better. I mean, it's a great time. Folks are open to changing and working with somebody else, working in a different way. So that's the first reason why it's a perfect time to grow your business. The other reason it's perfect is because I don't know anybody who isn't a little emotionally fired up. Let's go with that. So whatever side of those major issues that are on the screen that you're on, I don't know where you are. And for the purposes of this presentation, I don't necessarily care what side of you are on any of the arguments about the pandemic or politics or racial inequality or unemployment or the market. I don't care. What I know though is that everybody is a little more emotionally fired up, or as my wife likes to say, people have much less of a filter. There's much less of a filter right now. There's a much smaller buffer, depending on which metaphor you want to use, people are going to tell you how they feel. And that's a good thing. So I would rather somebody tell me when I have an idea and said, hey, what do you think about doing this giraffe money presentation and helping your client, your advisors understand how to make money better? What about talking to your clients directly and helping them understand how to better use their financial advisors? Some companies are like, yeah, it's a terrible idea. We're not going to do it. Other companies are hiring me to do interesting things like I'm doing right now. And the beauty of it is I'd rather somebody tell me no, so I know where they are, than someone say, yeah, it's probably a good idea. Let's talk again next month, which really means I don't want to talk to you, but I'm not going to tell you I don't want to talk to you. So the beauty is people are open to change, but they're going to tell you how they feel. And I can tell you in the financial services world, I've done very well because I get to the bottom of what do people feel and why, what do they want and why. The last two cases I did were both really big and the clients never saw an illustration. And the last question they both asked was, where are we sending the money? What company are we using? Because the company had nothing to do with any of it. It had to do with, what are we trying to accomplish? Do I trust that you understand how to help me? Do I believe in the plan? Let's go ahead and do it. It had nothing to do with something on page 16 of an illustration or whether or not what a crediting rate was or an assumed rate was or a guaranteed rate was. No one's ever asked. I mean, not in 10 years for me has anybody asked any of those questions. So the point here is people, again, understand the emotions, get to them so you get valuable feedback about what they really feel, because what they feel is going to trump what they think always. And people are open to change. So if you want to get into a new market, if you want to build more clients, if you want to build your business, now is the time. And with so many of the agencies I've worked with, I hear from everybody. I mean, I've talked to at least 25 agency owners who tell me the same thing. I said, how are your agents doing? And they said, some of them, a number of them are having the best year ever. They are embracing the change, a chance to do different things. And then there's a bunch of people over here who are waiting for things to go back to how they were. And it's never going back to how it was. I mean, life has been changed forever. So you can either sit in the event about how bad it is and wait for something to change, or you can focus on your response. And it's amazing how the leaders at most companies are different people than they were before. So if you've been in the middle of the pack or lower, or just lower than where you've wanted to be, it's a great time for you to change some things to allow you to get to the next level, because people are open to it. I mean, what you were doing wasn't working the way you wanted it to. If you weren't happy, well, now you have a great chance. It's a perfect situation for you. So I'm asking you to change, and I know change is not easy. So I'm going to ask you to humor me, and maybe you can see me on the screen. Maybe you can just see the picture. But what I'd like you to do is, if you could, this will take less than a minute, is take your two hands and I want you to clasp them together. So you have, you interlock the fingers. So it's a finger on the left, a finger on the right, and you alternate. And then if your right index finger is on top, then you put your left thumb, then your right thumb, or if you put the other one that goes the other way. So just clasp your hands the way that's most comfortable for you, and then look down at which thumb is on top. And it could be the left or it could be the right. And just keep track of what that is. Now, what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to unclasp them and move them down one so that whatever thumb was on top is now under the other thumb, and then all the fingers alternate underneath. So if it had started with the right, now it's the left on top. If it had started with the left, now it's the right on top. How does that feel? Now, I will often get, if we're in a live room with everybody's mics open, you get, ooh, icky, I don't like it. Somebody will shake their hands out. I wanna know how many of you went back and moved it to the other way. So if you started right, went to left and didn't like it, you went back to right on top. You know, so how many people did that? And the reason for this silly little exercise is that how you hold your fingers is completely insignificant. It has no impact on anything you do, but you've done one thing a certain way. Now you change it and it feels uncomfortable. And I get that, but it's really important that you don't just go back to the other finger on top. Life is changing all the time. You have to become comfortable being uncomfortable. Get comfortable being uncomfortable and understand that a little bit of change, this is where you grow. Remember the first time, you probably don't remember the first time you rode a bike, but maybe you remember the first time you helped your kids ride a bike, that how uncomfortable were they riding a bike? Really uncomfortable. And eventually they got comfortable. How'd you feel the first time you went in the water? How'd you feel the first time you got on a boat? How'd you feel the first time you drove a car? I'm teaching a kid to drive right now. I mean, how did you, none of these things, you were fantastic the first time. How were you the first time you filled out an application? The first time you did a sales call? The first time you interviewed for a job? The first time you interviewed somebody for a job? First time you had to fire somebody? I mean, all those things were difficult, but eventually you got through them. But if you never learned to interview, if you never went to school, if you never rode a bike, if you never swam, if you never asked someone to be your friend, if you never swung a bat or served a volleyball or kicked a soccer ball or did something else the first time, you never would have got to where you are. You have to work through these things. So everything else in your life, you've done a great job of suffering through the discomfort to get to some comfortable level where you can do something and enjoy it. It's the same thing in this career. If you want to get to the next level, you're going to have to try something a little differently. So, which gets us to the fourth thing, which is you have to get more time. I said they value time over money. You can actually stop time. And I don't mean stop time in a superhero way that you can stop time and move around and play pranks and do silly things, but you can actually stop time by getting more time. We each have 60 minutes in an hour. We have 24 hours in a day, 168 hours in a week, but you can get more done. And I don't know anybody who runs a business who doesn't say, I wish I had more time. Or you ask someone, how's business? They say, I just need more hours in my day. So Richard Branson, who started Virgin, multi-billionaire, had the quote, any successful entrepreneur knows that time is more valuable than money itself. Successful entrepreneur knows time is more value than money itself. So if you are constantly asking yourself with everything you do, how can this get done faster? How can I get somebody else to do it? Those are ways for you to get time, not how can I do more things? That is the biggest problem I find. We didn't go over it earlier, but when I was showing Dr. Saez's income inequality stuff, one of the very interesting statistics he had was that very few people who make it to the 1% who earn $400,000 a year ever make 2 million a year. If you have years where you can make 300,000, 400,000, 500,000, you will never make a million ever. And why is that? Because once you learn how to work hard to make $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 a year, you're making so much more than everybody else. The only way to get to 1, 2, or 11 million of income is for you to stop working and to start running a business. You need leverage. You need to create a business that works for you. It's a very different business selling insurance versus managing agencies or managing other insurance people. It's a very different thing giving investment advice versus running an investment company. It's very different. It requires different skills, and it's a big leap. So a lot of people get to the point where they're making so much money, it's almost too expensive for them to learn the lesson to do something else. At least they feel that way. So he found that there are more billionaires without a college diploma than there are people with a graduate degree. There are more billionaires who don't have a high school diploma than there are with a PhD. So that's crazy, right? I mean, it's crazy that people, the less education and the less money you can make doing, the greater probability of you making money building. So really important to think about that. And if you want to know how to do that, you want to know how to get more clients, how to get them faster, how to move through the sales process, how to be infinitely more valuable to your customers. These are the questions that you need to ask. These questions you need to ask yourself so you really understand the dialogue, who you're talking to, why you're talking to them, what the value is you provide. It isn't the product. I don't need you. No one needs you to get them an insurance, annuity, or investment product. They can get it from a million other people. That is, you are not the person who sells this. It's not the corner grocery store where I need milk, I'm on my way home, you're right there. It's not that at all. So you have to understand with your clients, what problem are you solving? Who needs that solution? What are they doing now? How's my solution better? What else do they need in addition to the one thing that they really want? How else can I help them? What aren't other people saying? What aren't other people doing? Those last two are so important. That's how you're going to differentiate yourself, by your story. What does it look like? What do they need? Really understand them and then figure out how you fill a gap nobody else is, because otherwise you're getting up early, working hard and hoping to find oil. Somehow miraculously your income will go from 60 grand to 600 grand. And it happens from time to time, but very seldom that you have to find that you're going to see a monumental shift. I coach all kinds of people in different industries, including sales. And they'll tell me, my goal this year is to go up from 200,000 to 400, from 3 to 6, from 1 to 2, from 50 to 100, from 1 million to 2 million, whatever it is. But, and then the question is, okay, what's the plan? What's the big difference? And it almost always is some minor tweak. And you can't have minor changes have major impact. It's very uncommon. So be asking these questions. And when you really understand these questions, you'll make the stronger attachment to your clients. And then they're going to work with you because you understand them, not because of some silly product. Because again, the products, David mentioned that I've been a top salesperson at multiple companies, and it's not because they bought my business. It's not because of commission rates. It's not because of, it's just products that happen to meet a client's need. And we'll find out after we get through the process, what do they need and who has the best product? So I don't particularly care what company writes the product. If it works for the client, then it's a win. So, you know, these are questions you have to ask. If you're a brand new agent, it's really important to think that for you to see that you don't need to understand the products. You don't need to understand the industry. And in some ways you have an advantage. So I run into this all the time with folks who say, well, I just changed industries. How can I possibly compete with the people who are there? Well, you have an advantage if you're going to talk to your friends who know that you used to do something else. You worked at a bank or you worked filing tax returns and now you're selling insurance and other financial products. They know that that's not what you've done for the last 25 years. So the beauty is you can say, I wanted to change industries. And you ask people those questions above. And when they answer those questions, because you haven't done this, you get to play the whole, hey, I just don't know. You know, I haven't done this forever. Why is that important to you? Like, tell me why that thing that you want is so important. What experiences have you had that made that where this didn't work? What kind of people have you worked with in the past that you didn't appreciate and why? You said this person was your best advisor you ever worked with. What did that person do differently? How was it so great? You can just ask questions to people and ask them what they want. Why haven't they done it? What's holding them back? How do they make that change? Like, these are things that you can do and then say, hey, I'll go try and find the people who can help you. And then you go, you work through Freedom, you work through other relationships you have to say, find me the person who can help my client with this issue. Somebody wants to put a retirement plan together, so that you go find the retirement person. Somebody wants to do some kind of non-qualified deferred comp. Great. Somebody wants better long-term care living benefits. Awesome. Find me the person to talk about that. Whatever it might be, go use the people in the industry and say, I'll go find those people for you so you can go back to doing what you love. Because if you loved researching financial products and other tools, then you'd be doing that instead of doing the thing that makes you a lot of money. So let me go be your, you know, I'll be your, you know, your research person, your runner, and I'll go find the answers for you. So it's actually great. I started my career. I mean, I was an actuary, MBA, mathematician, had an MBA in finance and entrepreneurial studies. And I spent the first handful of years in this industry selling for and promoting somebody who had an MBA, a PhD, a law degree, an LLM, and a postdoc fellowship at the London School of Economics. And he'd written 180 books. And so I went out and just said, yeah, I don't know anything, which was not quite true, but I downplayed my knowledge and just talked about somebody else. So I went around pitching somebody who was really good at stuff and people said, yeah, I'll talk to that person. And then the person paid me a referral fee. But that's how I started my career. And I did that with a number of different people until I knew enough and then I could do the work directly. So it's okay if you're new. You don't need to know how all this stuff works. The clients don't know. And quite frankly, they don't really care. So you know, there's so much time being spent helping you understand how products work when what there really should be is more time helping you understand how to interact with your clients and your referral sources so you make a connection. Because as I said, the products are, you know, the products just aren't that important. So when you're talking to your clients, if you ask your clients these questions, and I mentioned these to you earlier, if you ask these questions, your clients are going to tell you what they want help with. The clients are going to do the work for you. Imagine delegating your sales process to your clients and prospects. You can do this. I would ask everybody you talk to, and you should try it as soon as you get off this webinar, ask the people, hey, when somebody says the last 4 months have been crazy, 2020 is unreal, can you believe the crap we're going through? Whatever it is, ask the next three questions. Okay, so all in the midst of all this chaos, all this craziness, the crazy news, whatever it is that you're bitching and moaning about, I wouldn't use those words, but you get the point. Say, ask people, now what has changed? How are you looking at your health and your lifestyle now? Because of all this, do you want to move out of the city? Do you want to go someplace to the mountains? Would you like to be healthier because you're afraid of, you know, you have diabetes and you're afraid corona will kill you? Like, how has all of this changed your views about your health? How has all of this changed your views about your family? My dad was sick. And I had the benefit, because I had just closed that big case, to go get him out of a rehab hospital up in Rhode Island. I chartered a jet. I went up and got him. I brought him back, and I get to spend the last 17 days of his life with me here. We didn't know he was dying. We knew he was sick, but then it all took a turn for the worse and he died. But I had the benefit of saying, okay, I spent the last 17 days of his life. My father-in-law just got out of the hospital with pancreatic cancer. He's in my house. So just talked to him this morning before I got on this, and he's living with us for a little bit. And thank me for the time, and I'm happy to have it. and happy for the kids to have it, my wife to have it with her dad. My mother's back in Rhode Island and she has breast cancer, so stage four. So my sister and I are talking about, what do we do with mom? So is one of us going to live closer? Are we going to live closer to each other? Are we going to try and bring her down? I mean, we're thinking about how all this corona and all this quarantine, and you know, we took travel for granted. Where do we really want to be, and how do we want to, and how do we want to live going forward? So we're having these conversations. For a lot of people have had conversations about their views on their career and their business. So if you ask people, how have your views about your health and lifestyle, your family, and your business and career changed with all this chaos? And everybody has something. There's nobody who has gone through all of this. I can't imagine there's anybody in this country in witnessing all of this stuff over the last 5 months hasn't changed the way they think about health and lifestyle, family, or business and career. And what I find is, when I was doing a similar presentation for all of Prudential Insurance Company's clients around the country a few weeks ago, the statement was, most people will tell you money's more important, health is more important than money, family's more important than money, purpose and passion are more important than, and impact are more important than money. Yet the reason why people haven't made the changes to do those things is a money thing. So the big question is, if you felt better about your financial situation, would you be able to do those things? And so when you start the conversation with, how has your life changed? What is it you want to be different? How do you want to improve your life? Why haven't you done those things yet? The answer is almost always, I'm not sure if I can afford it. I don't know how to do it. I don't know who the people are. Well, if you could help them do that, what's more important, that you know the nuances of a living benefit clause or rider, or that you help somebody get comfortable with the fact that they can actually afford to leave their job they hate and start a company they want? Like, these are the places where you grow and you have really meaningful conversations, you make extraordinary connections, and ultimately you end up making more sales, making bigger sales, and things just go so much better. So the most important step for you as we get to this is you have to take action. Just sitting through webinars, going to conferences, and not doing something, you're never going to get there. And if you want to be that giraffe, you want to be the outlier who makes more money and stands above other people and has great relationships with clients and gets more referrals and works less and makes more money, you're going to have to stick your neck out. The giraffe is the only animal in the animal kingdom that has evolved to become more vulnerable. Every other animal has figured out how to burrow, hide, develop camouflage, do something to get away and evade predators. At 18 feet, it's really hard for a giraffe to hide. And it's not going to hide anywhere. It's not going to climb a tree. But by making its neck, which is its most vulnerable area, bigger, it allows it to see things others can't and reach things others won't. So you have to be vulnerable, put yourself out there, ask a lot of questions, be open to sharing things about yourself, admitting you don't know the answer to things. So ask questions that you don't know how to respond with the answer, but then go find those answers. There's a lot of power in I don't know. So when you think differently, you'll start seeing the whole business differently. And when you sales differently, you'll have much better outcomes and you'll get more out of it. And the big question for you then becomes, what are you going to do differently? And how vulnerable are you going to be to get to the next level? So as I'm trying to leave you and leave a little bit of time for Q&A if we have it, is if you want more stuff, obviously, Giraffe Money book just came out. I think it's fantastic. I wouldn't have written it if I didn't think it was good, but this is a good book for you and a good book for you to give to clients or referral sources. It's more about teaching people how to think differently about money. And there's no way someone reads this book and doesn't think, I need to lean on my advisors more, because there's a lot in this book is about leverage and using the people who are out there and doing what you do best and not trying to do everything. So I would definitely think you might get something out of reading it. If you don't like it, I will be happy to buy it back from you. I'm confident you'll get something out of it. I have two free gifts for you that Prudential negotiated this, and I'm just going to go ahead and pass it on because I like Dave and Raul a lot. So if you want to go to the website, thechrisjarvis.com, there's a book, 101 Questions, and then there's a book, 101 More Questions to help you better connect with your clients. So they're all in different categories. With these 202 questions, in addition to the four that I had on the screen earlier, these 202 questions, it's normally $20 each. They are free on the website. If you use the PRU2020 code, again, just feel free to use their code. Then you guys can get all of these for free. So please feel free to go to the site and download these and start using these questions. These questions are going to help you have good conversation and dialogue with your clients. And they're all designed to lead toward helping you better understand the clients and help you eventually sell and have a more productive career. So they're not just discussion conversations. These things all have a specific, they may seem very innocuous and very basic, but they all do drive toward the financial, financial success for you as a salesperson. So these are the most popular 202 questions that I found that I used over the last 20 years and people I coached did. So this is a freebie for you. No reason for you not to download those for free. If that's still not enough, there's an online course that we have, the 12-day turnaround, that it's a video every day. And I think we have 6 classes a week. And then the videos are 3 to 8 minutes. It's going to help you get more referrals, understand your message, differentiate, find your giraffe story, close more business, get bigger careers, grow your agency. I mean, all of it's in there. It's normally $500, but thanks to the very kind work with and negotiation of David and Raul and everybody at Freedom, if you use FRIENDS400 as the code, you're going to save $400. So instead of being $499, it's $99. So that is cheaper than the discounted codes I offered to other people. So it's the biggest discount we have. And it's really because I really like what everybody at Freedom is doing, and I want to help you guys. So feel free to use that. With that, I really want to encourage all of you to embrace your interesting, embrace your difference, your craziness, your unique whoever you are. There's something special about all of you, and don't be afraid to do something differently. That is how you get ahead. That is how you have a fantastic career. And again, I'm happy to be here. I want to provide resources and help any way I can so that not only do you not worry about money and finances, but also your clients feel the same way. So again, I'm Chris Jarvis. I'm very grateful you guys gave me some time here. I hope something landed with you. And David, if you want to take questions or you if you have time for that, I'm happy to sit and help any way I can. I'll turn it back over to you.
Great, Chris. Thank you, man. This was actually outstanding. A lot of the things that I needed to hear personally.
Good.
Thanks for beating me up, man. So if you guys are on here and you have a question for Chris, please submit them in the question in the chat box. Or if you'd like to say some kind words, or I like to see questions, comments, or obscene gestures, you're more than welcome to put any of those in the comment box. But Chris, tell us, man, where do you see the future of this industry going right now? And let's say just insurance in general, in the next 12 to 24 months, like where do you think the hottest, let's say, product will be for the average agent? Where do you think they should focus their energy?
Yeah, I think it's funny, the hottest product right now, it's gonna be you. I mean, you have to look in the mirror. This industry is going to massive automation. There's gonna be automation, there's gonna be job cuts, there's gonna be more people going into sales when they get laid off from all these companies. The market's probably gonna crash severely at some point very soon. There's just so much uncertainty. And at the end of the day, people don't, I made the comment in the webinar, what's more important, health or money? People say health. What's more important, family or money? People say family. What's more important, having passion and purpose in your life or money? And they say passion and purpose. Yet every time I ask anybody, why haven't you done the things that are going to make you healthy, improve your family life, and give you more passion? The answer is always money. And a good friend of mine and client met the Dalai Lama and had asked him, what's the craziest thing he's seen in the world? And he said, man. He said, okay, well, that's all right, fine. Why? And his response was, gender neutral, just man, humans, will sacrifice his health for money and then spend all his money trying to get back his health.
Wow.
And so, and I thought, and that's, so we hear this from a lot of different people. And I like the quote, what you do speaks so loudly, I can barely hear what you're saying. That ultimately my clients work with me because I get them to think differently. And because we have conversations that other people don't have. And some of that comes from asking probing questions. Some of it comes from being vulnerable and sharing your stuff. I mean, what did your people learn about me today? You learned that, my dad just died. My mother is sick. My father-in-law is sick and living with me. There's always something that comes out personally that I'm happy to share. I've been super successful, but in 2010, I was broke. So I had been kicked out of a company I owned. And I started from scratch and I had a non-compete and I went from making $600,000 to $700,000 a year to making zero, living on credit card bills and sleeping on somebody's couch. And so everything that I've done in the last 10 years, I came from negative to build back to where I am. So, I mean, you have to share some of that stuff to connect with people. I don't mean running around telling people your sob story and, you know, knock on their doors of, hey, I just got out of jail and, you know, would you buy this news, you know, this magazine subscription from me? But it's, but you have to be open and be willing to put yourself out there. And I just find that, you know, for me, I've been speaking for so long. And when I used to try and be the smartest person in the room, I got decent responses. But when I started getting more vulnerable and try and get into more of the emotional stuff and less into the tax and the finance and the technical stuff, that the connections became much stronger and the impact became much greater.
So that's a very good perspective to share with our team here, because as we know, I mean, most of us and most actual first time insurance agents or new insurance, and I like to say agent advisors, really, they really believe products are the difference. And so they constantly are challenged with the fact that they don't know enough. And so they just don't approach people. And what you're saying is it doesn't matter if you know enough about products, they have to buy you before they buy the product. Right.
Somebody who says, I don't understand the product well enough. I mean, that's bullshit. Just plain and simple. You do not need to know anything about the products because the products don't matter. I've been doing this a long time. I've got, you know, thousands and thousands of followers and thousands of past clients and people who trust me and like me and love me and respect me. And I've made money for it. And I have never had somebody call me and say, hey, Chris, I need an insurance policy right now. Can you sell it to me? I mean, it's never happened. And I'm relatively high profile. I mean, in this little world. So nobody asks for that. People call because they have a feeling, they have something that's going on. So you want to have the conversations about the feelings. People will not buy from you unless there's a couple things. They need to know that you're competent. And that comes from some years in the industry. Or if you don't have a lot of years, it comes with you being associated with an organization that's been around for a while, right? So it could be Freedom. It could be Liberty Tax. It could be whoever. So you don't need, you know, the company can have the credibility if you don't. That's why you join a company when you're new. Then once they believe you're competent, the second thing comes that they trust you. And trust is going to come from you not trying to jam something down their throat all the time. And the third piece, which kind of builds on trust, is most important. Especially with women, actually. In my house, my wife makes all the financial decisions. Just I'm the one who makes $1 million a year. But but what you learn from men are from Mars, women are from Venus, and people thinking differently is it's really important for people when they're making a decision to believe and understand that you understand them. Right? How important is it for people to understand? So doing more listening, I can listen to hours of conversation about people's challenges with their kids and who's not being more responsible and who's waiting for an inheritance. And like, they want me to understand not just that they want to leave money for their kids in a way that makes them responsible, that they don't put it up their nose, but to them, it's more important, you know why, because you know my kids' names and you know the challenges I've had. And we share challenges with, oh, my son got caught smoking pot, so we sent him to boarding school. Or, you know, I could at least have the conversation of, I can appreciate where you are, that idea that you know them, right? That you understand them is so important that you don't just understand what they want, but you understand why they want it. And I can look at somebody's data form they fill out for me, and in 10 minutes, I know exactly how the plan's going to end, but I'm still going to spend multiple meetings getting to know them because it's more important. It's not important that I know the answer. It's important that they know that I know what's important to them. And so that comes from, so you don't need to know anything about financial services to be successful. You just need to ask questions. And that's why I'm giving, again, that's why we talked about giving everybody the 202 questions for free. If you don't know what to ask, we're going to give you 202. And if you're still afraid to ask questions, then you know, you need to do some work in your own, you know, what kind of blocks are holding you back, or you got to find another career, because it's just not asking people, how has your life changed during this whole, like, coronavirus is crazy. Yeah, I know. Like, what have you changed? Like, what's your biggest win? I walk the dog with the kids now every day after dinner. Great. Like, what's the thing you wish changed? What do you hope doesn't go back? I mean, it's not hard to have conversations that are meaningful. You're a human being. You have conversations with your friends, your family. Like, be that same person and have those conversations with other people. We're all just people. Whether somebody's worth negative 300 grand or worth $1 billion, we're all still people. So there's no excuse for not having a conversation. It doesn't have to always end in a sale, and you don't need to worry about how do you pivot to a sale. It'll all present itself. I mean, I promise, it always does.
Wow. And very well said. I always think every time you're talking about this particular subject about connection, I think personally, I mean, from experience with agents, like when we get actually a new person who joins our team, I think that's the first thing we do. We don't really try to say, oh, how much money do you want to make? It's, hey, tell us what your real goals are. And that's actually the biggest challenge, I think, to be honest with you, is that most people just don't have a real goal in mind. Like what, and not finances. We try to find out, like, what do you want to do with your family? What do you want to have? What's your life going to look like? And once people get that picture, then you cater your training, your product alignment, whatever it is, to them, because it makes sense for them and you understand them. And this is beautiful stuff, by the way. I wish there was a lot more people on here because they need to hear this. They definitely need to hear this.
Well, what you just said too, David, hold on, I'm gonna throw one thing at the end. What David just said is really important. If you didn't hear that, if you're already working with David in Freedom, this is probably why. He's not asking you how much money you want to make. He's not talking about what's your payout and whether it's more or less than somebody you've already talked to. He's asking, what do you want to do with your life? And so think of it. Why are you working with David and Freedom versus working with any of the, you know, 1,000 other organizations who could offer you the same products? There's a reason why you picked it. And it's because they're asking you questions about what's important to you. And big companies don't do that. They say, oh, we have great contracts. Well, who gives a shit? Like, it's not that. Because at the end of the day, anybody can get you that stuff. But at the end of the day, you want to work with people who appreciate where you are. You want to work with people who, you know, so that whole idea that you chose to work with them for a reason, now take that same reason and make that the reason why people want to work with you. So you're already modeling it for them. So it's no surprise that the messages I have resonate with you and why you want your people to hear them. I mean, that's, you're doing it. So, I mean, I'm preaching to the choir with you.
Awesome. Raul, did you have something? Is that you?
Yeah, I just wanted to, I guess, piggyback on what Chris was saying. You know, we have this conversation with agents all the time. Yes, obviously you want to have relationships and you want to.
We lost you there, man.
Carriers, but the majority of the carriers that we work with, can you hear me?
Yeah, there you go.
Am I breaking up?
You were. Go ahead, man. We hear you.
Okay. There's a lot of agents out there making a lot of money selling really shitty products. So at the end of the day, if you work real hard on yourself and you make yourself a better professional, like Chris said, the products are always going to be secondary all the time.
Yeah, that's very good advice. Well, I'm looking to see if we have any questions. I don't see anything in the chat. Here we go. We got something. Everybody's saying thank you, Chris. A lot of people, amazing presentation. Appreciate what you've done for individuals, helping these companies. Eye opener, man. You got a lot of good reviews here. Oh man. And Chris asked the question, what's one thing you do differently today? And these are obviously a lot of people on here who really respect what you're trying to teach here. And hopefully everybody's sucking this in. And so Chris, I know we've gone an hour. I really appreciate you really taking the time to coach our team. If you guys are interested in the book, we put the Amazon link in there. If you saw that, so you can go order the book. Is there, unless you wanted to order from your site, which would be better for you, Chris? What's the better avenue? The book.
Amazon, you know, Amazon has the shipping down to a science. If you order it from me, then I have to go to the, you know, I'm going to delegate that out, and I'm going to model what I said. Buy it from Amazon. They will take some of the money, but they will deal with the BS and it will save me time. So
do not
buy it from my site, buy it from Amazon. And, you can do as I say and as I do. So I will gladly take fewer dollars to not have to fulfill the orders. How's that?
Well, Amazon's got his book. You can go there and order it. We've already put it in the chat. We'll also send it out if you're an attendee. You'll also get a link, an email from us rather, with the link to the book. Also for the two free gifts, or the two books. And then of course for the course, guys, $99 is pennies in comparison to what you're going to get from Chris. I mean, just spending time with Chris right now in this hour, do you feel like you got $99 worth of value? And if you didn't, you must have not paid attention. So join him on his mission here and educating people and having better relationships and thinking like a giraffe. I appreciate you again, Chris. Thank you so much for being here. And
David, Raul, it is my pleasure. Last thing I'd say to everybody is, if you have a goal, making a move toward your goal in the first 15 minutes increases your chance of success by 700%. So whatever you're going to do, if you thought there was something valuable on this, I challenge you to do something in the next 15 minutes. Send a note to somebody, call somebody, write something down, send an email, do something. Like, reach out to somebody, and see how it works. If you said, you know, whether, you know, I've seen people like David and Joanna and, you know, Melissa and a number of other people, Elizabeth, Donna, do something with it. Like, go do something with it, see the response, and then do it again. And once, and if you do that and it reinforces, it'll stick, versus it's a great idea and you'll get around to it tomorrow. Like, go ask some questions of people right now. And if you want to test it on somebody, you know, family members, friends, you know, it's not a sales call. It's just a, hey, given all this stuff, what's the biggest thing that you've seen change? What do you want to change? What's there and why haven't you done it? Just test drive it and see what happens. And when it works, it'll just change the way that you ask questions. And this is a habit. You have to keep doing it. And I guarantee if you ask questions like this every day for the next 30 days, I guarantee your pipeline will be considerably more robust than where it is right now. And I think you'll also feel better about what you do, and you'll feel like you're helping and connecting more than maybe selling. So anyway, that's my challenge to you, is to do something. Everybody, thank you so much. I really appreciate you doing that. And I hope you elevated your perspective a little bit and you'll see a better path and ultimately be the giraffe.
Thanks. Thank you, Chris. Thank you for everybody who attended. We'll be talking all soon. And by the way, if you like this, we're going to try to get Chris back real soon here, guys. Have a great day. Bye-bye.